So sorry, I will adjust the mic a little bit. Am I audible to everyone? I would like to particularly thank Professor Tiwari and Purnima for agreeing, as well as the team of NAOP. Slowly, they are trying to make me do a little bit more than I have done with NAOP, and thank you so much to Prabhat and Subhash for the honor that you're trying to extend to me. It's a great honor for me to be here as an invited speaker, because NAOP is not an organization. I'm not a psychologist, not a core psychologist, but a developmental and a cultural psychologist. So I think being invited as a speaker also indicates the status of my work as one, a significant field in psychology. So I would really like to start with expressing my gratitude. In the construction of this paper, I would like to also acknowledge the contribution of Professor Girishwar Mishra, and although you don't know it, Professor Bhavuk, I had a very brief conversation with you. Some of the inspiration in the paper that I, the long version of the paper that I have created, I will make it available to anybody who sends me an email. I would like to acknowledge your response to my queries. Thank you very much for that. I want to talk a little bit about the science and ethics of intervention programs in family and child welfare, because I see that as an area in which psychology can make tremendous contribution, and right now it is not. There is very little local psychology involved in the planning of this very extensive, very expensive, and very far-reaching intervention programs for family and child welfare. I see that as a significant gap, and I would like to start by giving you the key ideas of... beech-beech mein main photo dal dungi so that you don't get bored. So what are my main points? My main points are that contextual factors have become increasingly recognized. If we see the most of the presentations and the keynote addresses, contextual factors have become acknowledged. I mean, as a matter of fact, having cultural psychology as a branch is kind of problematic, because it's hard to conceptualize psychology without culture. Global interventions in social welfare persist with a universal view of family and child. And these, particularly based like the Convention of the Rights of the Child or the UNICEF Charter or the SGD goals, they are all based on a universal view of family and child. Practices promoted by international NGOs are what I'm going to talk about more specifically in this presentation. Intervention planned thus, I'm going to argue, are unscientific and, even more importantly, unethical. Given the resources invested in welfare, given the number of dollars that are spent, I think we need an audit of these programs. And I think that psychology is very well placed to do such an audit. It is for the sake of social justice and national development that my talk will refer to. Shifts in teaching and research have happened, although some of the presentations still borrow very heavily from a Western perspective. Particularly, I will refer to a couple this morning. I find that we fail to sometimes recognize work that is done locally, local ideologies. I mean, you will remember Professor Sudhir Kakkar's presentation yesterday, or day before yesterday, was it? About weird psychology, which is really based on, even in the West, on minority groups of the white, industrialized, educated, rich, and democratic societies. We've heard about glocal, which is like a compound of local and global. Professor Mishra has written about horizontal collaborations instead of vertical ones. The social sciences phenomena, Professor Prakash informed us yesterday, that social sciences phenomena, unlike natural sciences, are responsive to the theory and a method that is generated. A block of iron is not going to respond to what you think about it, but a human being or a family or an organic unit or a community, you actually land up making changes in their lives by the policies that you promote. Selective referencing and exaggerated claims. I'll be very happy to share all these references. My PowerPoint will be here, and I will be very happy to share these references. But Serpil and Samanag, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, have proved that the research on which policies like the UNICEF are based are selectively referenced and they make exaggerated claims. Therefore, we need a structural reorganizing of the discipline to make it more application-oriented. We heard Professor Prakash speak about that yesterday, and Sunil Bhatia has done a lot of work on it as well. Let's look at child rights and the CRC. CRC stands for the Convention for the Rights of the Child. It's based on industrialization and individualization, shrinking family size, low fertility rates, separation of grandparents. It's about 3 or 4 centuries old. In this view, children are seen as innocent and vulnerable, in need of protection. This insecurity is translated into global policy. UNICEF's agenda for, so at one point when UNICEF was first set up, it was set up as an emergency fund. All of you will know that history. But when the emergency, post-war emergency was over, I don't know if I started recording. When the emergency was over, UNICEF had nothing to do. And therefore, the child rights issue came up as something that they could contribute towards. There has been a failure of structural adjustment programs in the past. Loans, World Bank loans, IMF loans have failed to change the figures related to poverty. That's when international aid enters. Child rights as an idea is firmly based in globalization. Again, we heard yesterday when Professor Prakash was giving a history of applied psychology, there is a point at which applied psychology became more globalized in the sense that you wanted to please an international audience by signing the treaty. So in 1989, India signed the CRC. Just a distraction, or an attraction, whichever. So the Convention of the Rights of the Child, written in 1989, was signed and ratified by the world's countries. How many of you know or are aware that the United States of America has not yet signed the treaty that was written in its own, UNICEF is the center of UNICEF, of course, Geneva as well, but a huge part of the UN headquarters is in the US. Why didn't they sign it? They feel that signing a treaty hands over the sovereignty of the American family. What does that mean for those of us who are signatories? That we do? Unfortunately, I feel we have not had a robust debate about the child rights issue in our country. This is a paper by Vasanthi Raman, which makes an international argument that we need a critical debate. The child was globalized and separated from its context, and development was separated from culture. This is Erica Berman's point. In addition to that, there is also with globalization, there is this global epidemic of sameness. People wanted everyone to have, you know, one size fits all policy. It's easier to implement if you believe that everyone's the same. We are all human beings, so therefore everyone should become the same. Everyone is not the same. It is an idealized version of this is what a perfect child looks like. We've seen plenty of photographs from UNICEF. By the way, as soon as I finished my PowerPoint and I sent it off, thanks to the supervision that the internet does, I received a request from UNICEF in my email to donate towards childhood. Diversity is seen as a threat to Western imperialism. How are these people surviving? They should be dying with the kind of poverty they have. Buildings, arts, and crafts have become heritage. Why is childcare or family practices or language not? I think language is now being recognized with the work particularly of Professor Devi. I hope all of you know about the Bhasha Institute and his work. If you don't, please look at his latest publication called The Crisis Within. It's very informative. He, in fact, has given a more optimistic view than we had earlier that actually it's not as bad as it seems and languages are surviving. Then we've started something called the policing of childhood. I don't know how many of you are aware of the fact that Indian children being brought up in the West by children of temporary immigrants, like you see a tech person has gone to Norway, for instance. This is an example of a case that I have been following up. The mother was feeding the child was sleeping with the parents, and both the children were taken away by child protection services. So we have come under, there is no recognition of the cultural practices of India. It is seen as child abuse, and I think that is a very unfair thing, and I think it is important for psychology to make an entrance here as well. The age of globalization. Then you have, the narratives from Africa are very interesting. And a Nigerian scholar, she's actually an author, Chimamanda Adichie, has talked about the danger of a single story. I think childhood is in danger of being defined, being a single story. So I want to take an exact quote and see if it bothers you as much as it does bother me. Globally, over 200 million children live in poverty, have poor health services, nutrition, and psychosocial care. Is it all one bunch? Is it automatic? Do you think all parents who have an income below a certain amount have poor psychosocial care? I think it's a very unfair statement, and I hope you're upset about it as I am. Subsequently, they have low incomes, high fertility, and high criminality. तो वो गरीब है तो वो ये बन गया वो बन गया वो चोर भी बन गया बिकॉज उसके माँ बाप उसको ऐसे पाले हैं वो चोर भी बन जाता है एंड प्रोवाइड पुअर केयर फॉर देयर ओन चिल्ड्रन देयरफॉर परपेचुएटिंग द साइकिल सो देयरफॉर यू कांट डू एनीथिंग अबाउट इट यू गोइंग टू बी पुअर यू गोइंग टू बी अ क्रिमिनल यू गोइंग टू हैव पुअर केयर एंड देन यू गोइंग टू प्रोवाइड पुअर केयर आई थिंक दैट दिस पर्टिकुलर डॉक्यूमेंट ऑफेंड्स मी very greatly, and I think we need to do something about it. People don't go to school not because they don't want to. I think almost everyone I meet wants to get into school, but it is because of the fact that they are migrants, they move from one place to another, admissions are very hard, and honestly speaking, the Huck Foundation had done a study, if everybody wants to get into school, there aren't enough schools. And these allegations that they provide poor care are also unscientific and I think unethical. The CRC model of the global family is therefore all these things. Nuclear family, single child or few children, separation and autonomy, alag sona chahiye from day one, which is something that we have to work against. I'm sorry about the typographical error. But there is this discontinuity between childhood and adulthood, conjugality, that is the husband-wife relation. This is Patricia Oberoi's point. The husband-wife relationship is the center of the family, but in Indian families, and I go to the next slide, In Indian families, it is not the husband and wife that is the core unit, according to Patricia Oberoi. It is the mother-child unit, or it is the child who is the center of the family unit once the child arrives, or the children, so to speak. Sibling care relationships are very common. We have multiple caregiver settings. In my study, there were the number of many children with many mothers, or many children with many caregivers, was the highest frequency. Single mother, single child, without anybody coming or going, were only 6 out of a total of 52 families. So for us, the single parent-child format is actually the rarest of phenomena. There are always other people interacting. There are many languages. Why? There is an acceptance of multiple languages, but not in the way that we use it. Multilingualism in India, as Professor Mohanty has shown, is a very different. Another thing I want, this actually came up in my conversation with Professor Bhavuk, that somewhere we have lost the importance. My mother knew ek chauthai ke pahade. She knew tables for half in Hindi. I don't even know regular tables. The importance of memory in the learning traditions of India, primarily because it was dominated by the oral tradition, was very high. We have lost that, and I don't think we have gained anything in its place. So somewhere we need to reflect on the fact that there is so much in which makes the global agenda of agencies rather hard to apply. Let's look quickly at the science of scarcity. Poverty was earlier attributed to structural causes. Now they are saying poverty is because of psychological causes. Unka dimag kharab hai, isliye wo gareeb hai, wo daru peete hai, isliye unke paas paisa nahi hai. It's actually not true. Please look at the work of Mulayanathan and Shafir. They have done fascinating experiments in economics where they have actually put people in situations of hunger and deprivation, and people's minds act differently. So let us not be unfair on people living in disadvantage to say wo disadvantaged isliye hain ki wo aise hain. Nahi, wo aise hain kyunki unke paas kam hai, unko bhook hai, unke paas paisa kam hai. So that argument that we have taken from the West, that agar inka ek ye button theek kar do, ye garibi se nikal jayenge, par hum yahan pe international NGO ka, there was one episode that one UNICEF official told me by mistake. She was a friend of mine. She said there was a time in which cinema tickets ke upar they had put a welfare fund. And I believe that subsequent to that, there was a huge revenue generated. There was a crisis meeting in UNICEF. What do we do now? We have to reinvent problems because now India has its own funding. So please understand that international NGOs do not have a very, their orientation is towards their own survival and not towards the survival of children living in poverty. So why am I asking for a change and an audit, and why do I think that psychology can contribute very strongly here, is that Raghuram Rajan and Subramaniam have done a clear international assessment and audit of welfare programs, and they're saying they are not working. They haven't changed poverty statistics. So not therefore that we should throw away interventions, but we should change the way in which interventions are done. I'm going to run a little bit faster because I wish to complete and come to my last point. So I think interventions are attempting to change culture. Do they have a right to do that? I think we should have a much greater say, and academics in India should have a much greater say in what constitutes these programs. Programs will tell you, sit and talk to your child, read a story to your child every night before sleeping. Is that a practical suggestion for a family that lives in poverty? Are there no other ways in which we can suggest. We expect school hours to follow a particular. It is only local agencies that will understand that people who have different schedules, farming communities need different timings of schools. So our programs, so my point that I'm trying to make is not that we should throw out interventions, but we have to have interventions that are closely adapted and linked to the ways in which we live. We need to re-examine how development is defined and studied. And there is enough work, even in the West, that is criticizing intervention programs. They're an example of conversion. Look what happened to Andamans. I mean, we are now crying about, you know, what's happened to the, you know, that missionary who came to the Andaman Islands and, I mean, it's sad that he died. He didn't deserve to die, but I think he had a misplaced agenda. But what the British did to the greater Andamanese, do we remember that? I mean, why should I see intervention as being promoted by international agencies as pretty much a conversion? It's not conversion of religion, but it's a conversion of a way of life. When philosophical ideas are translated into practice, there is a price of passage. Ek kimat hum log chuka rahe hain, jo jiske bare mein hame na pata hai aur na hum kuch kar pa rahe hain. My point is, I think more people in this domain should get involved in this very, very large field. So again, why we still need interventions is because between Professor Kakkar's wonderful presentation about ideological connectedness and sympathy, there is also the connectedness of separation. हमें अपनी फैमिली से इतना प्यार है कि अगर हम झगड़ लेंगे तो हम उनसे कभी बात ही नहीं करेंगे. Let us not only talk about the pretty stories, they are there. But there is also the reality of separation and subjugation and hierarchy and discrimination. So does it mean we are this or that? Yes, that's what Ramanujan says, that if you say anything about India, the exact opposite also can be true. But the dominant voices ignore marginalized sections. Yesterday, I had the privilege of being a chair to a session on sexuality, in which a scholar, this is Professor Day and her group, a scholar presented the added beliefs about sexuality of young women with blindness. I had tears in my eyes at the end of it. They have no intervention programs. They had no idea what a male or a female body ever looked like. There is no program that they have to go to. Let us please look at all these sections. So there are so many pockets. There are so many fault lines in our own culture that are being ignored when interventions are trying to go by a foreign agenda. So we need to look. We need our own people to look at our own fault lines and contribute there. Undeniably, families living in disadvantage need support. I mean, Professor Sinha wrote, is it 1976? I don't, my memory fails me, but I remember it was when we were students that the deprivation book came out. If you read it today, the story is not very different. So maybe somewhere we need to do something more. Psychology for social justice. We need sustainability. Sustainability can only happen if it is generated from within. Quality. We are sending children to preschool at age 3 to schools that are not even safe. Do we have a right to do that? Because preschool education is good for school retention, so it's like an argument that children are going to face a lot of violence, so shuru se hi danda marne lag jao, right? But unless we can ensure quality schools, why are we pushing kids to preschool education? I would say set up good schools, make sure the Anganwaris are perfect, at least safe, and provide what they say they are providing, and then get the children there. Rather than equality, I think we should look more at equity. And the CRC talks about neglected children. Neglected by whom? They're not neglected by the parents necessarily. They're neglected by the state. And I think we forget that the poor have a right to their dignity. Hum bhool jaate hain. Wo gareeb hai, to usko laat maar do. It's less of a human being. That's exactly what the West is doing to us. Aur hum itne achhe wo seekhe hain ki hum apne logon ko hi ye karne ko tayyar hain. Diversities can be of different kinds. And again, the human rights issue, as I was telling you, the Andaman Islands example, when individuals' rights, I mean, you want the people to reach salvation, he wanted to show people a way out of darkness. Which darkness are you talking about? And which light are you talking about? I think we need to make sure that people agree with what is being attempted with them. Local theories need to dialogue with global approaches, protect family life as heritage, protect languages as heritage. Yes, there should be universal availability. Take the good elements from everywhere, but don't throw out your own. Promoting local foods, art, craft, other resources, seeking local solutions and protection for children, particularly Indian parents living abroad. Thank you very much.